you, Imelda, and colleagues, really, for the invitation to be here. It's always very lovely to come and visit this crazy busy city of Manila, but really marvelous to be here. Yes, so I want to speak about regulation and governance for health, and starting with this picture. I'm originally from Glasgow, and this is a picture of a part of Glasgow, and I always use it when I speak about health, because what you're not going to hear me speaking about is health services or medical services. Not that that's not incredibly important for health, but if nothing else, to walk out of this room understanding that there are many opportunities for improving population health if we think outside of the health system. How we think about the physical environment, the social environment. In Glasgow, where I'm from, we can't do an awful lot at the moment around the natural environment. It always rains and it's always cold and wet, and that matters for our health. But it's the combination of these different factors. So I want to speak about, or I've organised my remarks in three ways, around the policy problem as it relates to health, and I'll do that specifically in the context of the Philippines. Then a question, and it's a sort of a broader question, but of course matters for health and many of the other issues that we were speaking about yesterday and for the rest of today, is why regulate in the first place? And then what's the range of regulatory approaches that we might take? And I want to expand again a little bit on how we might think of approaches to regulation and governance. So the health issue, that this is in the Philippines context, but it's very, very similar in many countries around the world, is that the health conditions that people are living with and the health conditions that people are dying from are now predominantly non-communicable diseases. So things like diabetes, cardiovascular disease, stroke, mental illness, these are the conditions that affect the majority of the world's population today. And what you see on that slide is analysis done by the Burden of Disease Study in the US, which is this phenomenal piece of work that's happening all over the world, and the analysis particular to the Philippines. All you really have to look at in that slide are the blue bars. And what the blue bars are indicating in the Philippines context is non-communicable diseases, with the exception of a few issues in green, but the blue bars, and that's the percentage change that's happened over a number of years within the Philippines context. So for the population in this country, from a health perspective and thinking about how to address health issues, those, I would argue, are where attention needs to be paid. Diabetes, cardiovascular disease, mental illness. And what is it that's contributing to that burden of disease? I'm not going to go through all of that, other than to say, look at the top handful of things. The number one risk factor for disability and early premature death in the Philippines is diet. And I will say a bit more about that, because that's an area that I do quite a bit of work on. So you've got diet, you've got smoking, you've got high blood pressure, that's also related to dietary factors, not exclusively, but to dietary factors. So if you're going to pay attention to the burden of disease in this country, and if you're thinking about the proportionate contribution of the health system and of healthcare costs, right now and going forward in the country, these are the sorts of issues that really we should be paying attention to. So if that's the policy in the health space, if that's one of the major, or if those are the major health policy challenges, what's the approach that could be taken to regulation and governance? we had a lot of discussion around the efficiency and the effectiveness aspects up there. Very important, certainly in the health system, and apologies, I don't have the figure in the Philippines, but the health system budget in many countries around the world is one of the highest proportion of expenditure for a national government. So of course you want an efficient system, and if, I would say you most certainly want an effective system, but you might also say the purpose of addressing these issues or regulating around these issues is also from an equity perspective. I don't mean that from a financial, I mean from a social equity perspective. And if you think of the issues that we were hearing yesterday of some of the inequalities that exist across the country, then regulation from an equity perspective might be very important. And I would certainly argue from a health perspective, all of those health conditions and risk factors that I showed in the Philippines context are highly socially graded. Usually it's the more socially disadvantaged groups, whether spatially, economically, also by gender, are the ones who are much more likely to experience the highest burden of disability and premature death from those conditions. So for what purpose in that regard? The other side of it in the health space is, do we want to focus attention in terms of regulation and governance around the promotion of well-being? Do we want to think about how we prevent those conditions, those health conditions or those risk factors that I've spoken about? Or, so they're not mutually exclusive by any means, do we want to treat people that have those conditions? And what I suggest is often when we speak about health, we go very, very quickly to treatment. I suspect many of you in the room came in here thinking you're going to hear me speaking about treating people with health problems. And I'm not. I'm actually not going to say pretty much anything about that now. Because what I'd like to argue is, from a country's well-being perspective and from a financial perspective, we've got to stop the tsunami of the risk factors and the health conditions that start in early years. So if we do want, for what purpose, around efficiency and effectiveness, then we've got to prevent these conditions. So I'd suggest, we also were speaking yesterday about leading lives that we have reason to value. I can't remember exactly which colleague said that yesterday. And that's, of course, front and centre when you're thinking about what is it as a nation that we may be trying to achieve. So leading a life that we have reason to value, part of that is how do people prevent poor health, how do they also seek treatment when, of course, when they are sick. And there's three dimensions to this: material resource. So of course we as individuals, but also as communities and as nations, need enough material resource to lead that healthy life. We also need control over our lives. So the sorts of challenges that were being raised yesterday are incredibly detrimental for people's mental health in particular, but also for physical health, because you lose control over ability to make decisions that matter for your well-being. And then political voice, which I'll come back to shortly. I don't mean for you to be able to see all of that, and I'm certainly not going to go through it. This was an analysis that we had done across the Asia-Pacific region, looking at the sorts of policies and actions that can impact and that have been impacting in different countries, the health of communities across. So if we're going to think about the prevention, the promotion of well-being, the prevention of poor health, and also the treatment, these are the range of areas that we need to be acting in. That provides all sorts of opportunities. For those of you who may not think you work in the health sector, the actions that you take in your different sectoral areas matter for health. So there's real opportunity within the country. I'll just give you an an example of how this plays out. So these are some analyses from Australia. So we were speaking yesterday about employment and work and income and what, you know, what that gives. The quality of work matters for your health. So poorer quality work, so when we were speaking about the employment opportunities within the call centres, I've now just forgotten that acronym that you were speaking about yesterday, I hope you know what I'm referring to. So there's opportunities for employment and the value that that brings to the Philippines. But the quality of that work, the control that people have, you know, if you're in a call centre and you're sitting there all day and you have a headset on, you have very little control over your work. Other than having the mute button to complain to your fellow colleagues about the person on the other side of the phone, you have very little control. And that's detrimental to your mental health. So the figure on the left-hand side, the depression figures, the bar which is highest is the sort of work that's in the call centres in many countries around the world. And that's worse for your mental health than not having a job at all. So when we think about work and we think about labour policy, we have to, and if we're thinking about the prevention of some of these big challenging health conditions, there's a real opportunity. There's also the question around health and social services. These are some analyses that colleagues have done globally, but I've just pulled out the figures for Greece, when there's a cut to frontline services. So in Greece, the cut to the needle exchange programme, because of some sort of austerity measures, and of course when you're trying to balance government budgets, there are cuts, there are trade-offs that have to be made. But that had a direct impact on health. You can see what happened in terms of HIV infections within a very short period of time. So when there's a policy decision, and I would say that's a regulatory decision, to cut frontline services, you're going to see the impact on human health very clearly there. And again, relating to the discussion we had yesterday around the inequality within the Philippines, the inequality within countries, income inequality or spatial inequalities, again, that matters for health. I won't unpack what's on that slide. Suffice to say, this is in high-income countries, and it's a little bit less robust when you start to move into some of the lower and middle-income countries. But the more unequal a society, the poorer the health in those societies. So I put these slides up to suggest that there are all sorts of opportunities across a whole range of policy areas to prevent poor health and promote well-being, having the freedom to lead a life that we have reason to value. So how might we go about doing all of that? And so the idea of a suite of regulatory approaches, and I and many of our colleagues in RegNet and the School of Regulation and Global Governance take a very broad approach to regulation. This is a very sort of general articulation of how we think about and how I think about regulation and governance. So there's a whole load of instruments, tools, ways, and a whole load of actors and institutions, which I'm going to pick up on shortly, in influencing the course of events. So quite different to how we were thinking about regulation yesterday, but I would suggest what this provides is, again, opportunities for a whole load of different actors who work in many different ways to influence the sorts of issues that I've just been speaking about that matter for health and social well-being. So there's a range of different approaches that might be used. Some of them fairly obvious. I'm going to now speak a little bit more about food, hence why you see some of the food issues captured in here. But did you ever think of television chefs as being a regulatory tool? So what you get happening, and I don't know about here in the Philippines, but certainly in many countries around the world, how many television programmes about cooking, I mean, really how lots because I'm rubbish at cooking, but you have all of these television chefs who are then expanding in terms of what we do, what they do. That sets norms for approaches to cooking. It sets norms for the types of foods that become acceptable in households. That's a regulatory instrument. So within the food system, apologies, I suspect you can't read that. I put this slide up. This is some analysis that we've done globally to see what are some of the actions that can be taken by a whole suite of actors, not just government, but a whole suite of actors that can influence healthy food. So I mentioned the TV chefs as one example. There are many, 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 many things, and really the point of that slide is to say, look at the many entry points that we can of different forms of regulation that can make a difference. So when somebody says it's about the education of individuals as to what they should be eating, I would say that's a very, very small part of it. That's there in the centre of that slide. That's a very small part of it. There are many other factors in that complex system up there on the screen that influence what people eat, what people like and what people eat. Let me pick up on a couple of things, because I know this is a live topic here in the Philippines, but some analysis that I've been involved with in Mexico about sort of soda tax. So here's a fiscal lever, a fiscal regulatory instrument. Mexico brought this in, so the 1 peso and a litre of sugar sweetened beverages, I'm just going to say soda for brevity, and it made a difference. We saw a decrease of about 12% in sales. There's a whole other stuff, of course, associated with that. But there was a quite remarkable shift that happened in terms of the sales of soda. Remember, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, related to dietary risk factors, and I can show you evidence I've got on the slide, but I can show you a whole suite of epidemiological evidence that shows the relationship between the consumption of soda and those health conditions. So if we want to do something, or if in the Philippines if you want to do something, you've got to shift the consumption of this sort of food. There was, of course, incredible resistance from those industries. It's big business. But how did that tax come to pass? How did it get there? And at this point is, I think, a very interesting part of the story. This is the government's question around this. There was a whole load of mobilisation that took place, and again, something that we didn't really pick up on yesterday, and I'm sure we'll do more of it today. But a whole mobilisation around coalition building around this issue. I won't read through it. So very clear on the vision of that coalition. They wanted this soda tax. There was a very strong relationship or direct conversation that was going on within the Ministry of Health. And there was a whole load of very clever framing within the communication campaigns, and I'll come back to that in a second. So something I think to reflect on, particularly here in the Philippines, if you think, and I know the discussions are very live and there's a lot of resistance to this fiscal lever within the Philippines. I do want to mention trade, because we were having a lot of discussion about it yesterday, and it's an area that I do a lot of work on, particularly to do with food and nutrition. So we were speaking yesterday about food as a commodity, as a tradable commodity, particularly I think we had some discussion around rice. I'd like us to think about trade in a way of what does it bring into the country, and what are some of the issues related to health. So there's a whole lot of ways that trade and investment can be good and also bad for health listed up here. I'm not going to go through all of that, I do just want to pick up on the health part at the bottom. But each of those aspects of trade, you may not have thought of trade and investment from a health perspective before, but there are some of the ways that can improve health, as well as, of course, depending on how it's done, it can be risky for health, and let me show you how. So still with the food issue, so Thailand wanted to, so a health policy challenge was marketing of junk food, highly processed food to children. And the health minister wanted to introduce this traffic light system. That's what the little thing over on the right hand side is referred to as a traffic light system. And so from, as a health policy regulatory instrument, bringing the traffic light system, global evidence that this is a good thing to do. But of course that's a technical barrier to trade if it's not applied equally across all products. And that wasn't going to be the case. So there, I'm interested in policy coherence. So health policy goals, trade policy goals. And because it was a technical barrier to trade, it was going to be a mandatory label, then this was what was suggested, this textual warning label. From a health policy perspective, that's much of less effective regulatory instrument. The other issue in terms of trade and investment, and when we were speaking yesterday for the Philippines opening up much more, certainly from an economic perspective, that makes a whole load of sense. I would say, let's think about what does that mean for what comes into the country. So from a health perspective, what happened in Vietnam, you don't need to worry about the Philippines in this instance, because you entered into WTO earlier than Vietnam. But when Vietnam opened up, the way that they opened up in terms of investment liberalisation, so the line on the top is the growth of sales of sugar-sweetened beverages into Vietnam. I don't know what you did in the Philippines that was much more protective for you in terms of the increase in sales of sugar-sweetened beverages, but Vietnam didn't do particularly well. That was the rate of increase of sugar-sweetened beverages. And remember, going back to the relationship between diabetes and cardiovascular disease, then that's a concern, that's a health concern. So it's a question of how do we think about what are the trade-offs that need to get made within the trade and investment world relating to, and then relating to the health goals. I don't have an answer to that, but I'm just posing some of these challenges. Within Australia, we introduced the cigarette plain packaging. So there was an incredible regulatory tool. We changed the packaging of the cigarettes. This was part of the Framework Convention for Tobacco Control's suite of regulatory approaches. We did that, and there was an incredible pushback from the tobacco industry. There was a whole load of challenges to the Australian government. So there's a health policy, a health minister being incredibly progressive and being challenged within both our domestic courts and then in the international courts. Where we started to see things get very interesting, I think, was when it went through the investment treaty, the bilateral investment treaty, that's the third point there, and through the investor-state dispute settlement clause. So the only reason I'm putting it, but actually the Australian government won, we still have cigarette plain packaging. So from a health perspective, that's an incredible regulatory intervention. But of course it starts to create challenges and tensions within that investment treaty space. So I raise that as something for us to think about. So the challenge of policy coherence, I'm not going to set any real time on this, just to say when we think about regulation and for what purpose, and we're trying to achieve some sense of policy coherence, then there's different ways that we can do that. There's just some suggestions up on that slide. But I want to finish by speaking about some of the broader governance challenges. And the question of, so the issue, so I'm a health person, I think the health issue is the most important, that if you're an economist, you might think something else is much more important. So there's the health issue. But there's a whole lot of factors that influence the development of those regulatory approaches or the development of those policy issues and coherence. There's a whole suite of actors. I pointed to some of them with the Mexico example. So there's the government players, there's the civil society organisations, the there's the industry actors, and there's a whole contestation of power going on. I could do a whole other talk about what those power aspects are. But we've got to be conscious of that and recognise that in thinking about those regulatory approaches. How we frame the issues. The Mexico case was a beautiful example, certainly from a civil society perspective and a coalition building, of talking about why is soda killing our children? So there was the framing of that, the issue in that way, that gained a lot of traction. Which minister of health or any other minister would want to be killing children? Nobody, of course, ever wants to do that. So how those issues get framed really matter. And then, of course, the political context, how do you get traction? I would argue in the context of the trade and health issues that are to do with nutrition, right now is a policy window of opportunity. We have the UN Declaration on a decade of action for nutrition. We've got the Sustainable Development Goals that are all about policy coherence and have got trade as an implementing mechanism. So at the global level, there's a real political window, policy window of opportunity. I, of course, can't comment in the Philippines. So that's my last slide. That's what I would leave you with. I hope, really, just the point of health is not just about treating disease. There's all sorts of opportunities across a whole load of different policy areas and therefore different regulatory approaches. I would say let's be model mongers. There's no one size fits all. There's a whole suite of regulatory